We often tell you here at GMBN Tech how to look after your bike, and in particular, we tend to look at things like the transmission because that's the stuff that really has to put up with your day-to-day use. But equally, your suspension forks get a bit of a hard time, and we have told you a few tips on that, but the shock altogether is something that gets left behind. Now, don't be put off. We're going to show you how to do a very basic air can service on your air shock. You don't need any specialist parts or any specialist tools. It's dead simple, and it will make your shock feel plusher, and it will continue working better. Now, an air can service is fundamentally the same on any air shock. So it doesn't matter whether it's ROX or Fox Shocks or Devia or any others. It's the same principle. You slide the sleeve off, clean it, put it back on again. Now, on this particular bike, you can see how dusty the shock is all around the seal here. It's in pretty bad condition, so it does need a bit of TLC. Just something to point out though, some bikes have cable operated lockout like this one. So if doing that, you might want to replace the cable at the same time because of the way it's crimped on there. It just requires rerouting a cable through there and then removing the shock. Nice and easy. I'm actually going to show you on a RockShox shock that's got a new fitting on the end, so it's a little bit different to this one. These are very simple. You remove the bolt, just take the bushes off the top of the shock, and then you can slide the body off. But on the new style RockShox shocks, it's a little bit different. So you're going to need a bunch of tools to get this job done. It's pretty simple stuff, despite what you might think having a look at this lot. First up, you're going to need some sort of shop towel, rag, something lint-free, basically, so it doesn't sort of get in the way of everything else. Next up is advice. Make sure if you do use one, it has soft jaws because you don't want to damage the end of your shock on there. It's not an essential though, you can do this job without that. I like to use a strap wrench because it does make removing the shock can easy, especially if it's oily and slippery, because it can actually apply a lot of pressure and it won't damage it. But you can do this with your good old fashioned hands. Next up, you want to have some sort of evaporating cleaner. So isopropyl alcohol, brake cleaner is very good for that, as is contact cleaner because it's essentially isopropyl alcohol. Like I say, anything that evaporates is what you want to clean it with. A fine pick is a good idea because you can actually take out debris from those seals if there is any. You can use a very fine screwdriver though, so don't feel that you have to have a specialist tool. That said, you can't beat the proper tool for the job. Now, you're gonna need some dedicated shock oils and greases. On the table here, we've got some Wilkins and SodaStrom grease, we've got some RockShox Dynamic Seal Grease, RockShox Butter, and some Float Fluid from Fox. Any of these things is going to be great for the job. You're going to need some threadlock for when you put the shock back onto your bike, because shock bolts do have a habit of rattling loose. You'll need appropriate Allen keys for your particular setup. It's normally a 5mm, but it can be a 6 in some cases. And on this particular RockShox shock, you're actually going to need some smaller ones, just 3 involved as well. A shock pump is obviously needed. You're working on a shock. You're going to need to remove the air pressure from that and reinflate it afterwards. A pair of safety glasses is a good idea whenever you're working with oils, be that brakes, forks, shocks, etc. You can minimize the chance of anything spraying out by removing the shock can whilst it's on the bike, of course, and which is a way I'm going to show you can get away with not using a vise. But if you're working on a desktop, having glasses is always a good idea. Rubber gloves are a great idea for protecting your hands. In this case, the oil isn't corrosive as such, but it does mean you're going to have a bit more grip, and it's obviously not going to get into your skin anyway. And finally, a nice metal GMBN workshop spec cup to keep you hydrated. So if you're removing your shock to do this in a vise on a workbench, now is the time to start removing those bolts. However, I'm just going to show you another method that doesn't involve having to have a vise. Now, this is quite useful if you haven't got a dedicated area to work on your bike. You can also do this with a bike on the ground out of a work stand, but you might want a friend just to hold the saddle up so the bike doesn't drop when you do this. So first up is to remove the little air valve cover, and then you want to take note of the air pressure you're running in your shock, just because it makes it a bit easier and you don't have to faff around doing your sag again at the other end when you put it back together. So I'm just going to connect my shock pump, take note of my air pressure in here, and then I'm going to slowly release the air. When you release the air pressure from the shock, don't do it in one big hit. Do it nice and slowly. It's a good idea to do it with a shock pump. If there's any air left in that negative chamber, it can make it difficult to remove the air sleeve, and it also can make it a bit dangerous too. I'm not going to be using a vise for this. I'm actually going to remove the air sleeve while it's actually still on the bike. Then I'm going to remove the shock bolts and take the shock out of the bike to clean it and inspect it. Now, I'm using a strap wrench here. They're pretty cheap. You can get them on Amazon for a few quid, and they're really, really useful in particular for this job, because it applies the right amount of torque, you're not going to damage it, and even if it is a bit slippy, you can still get good purchase with these. You can remove the air sleeve just by using your hand, but it can be a bit tricky, especially if you have a piggyback to get good purchase around the shock. So it's just a case of running the strap back through that strap wrench and it undoes, as most things do, anti-clockwise. There we go. Now, if you're doing this in a vise, don't be surprised if the lower part of the tube spins as well. It's not a problem. And there may well be a little bit of a pop of just the air releasing when you get to the end of the threads. There we go. Nice and easy, no vise needed. Now, for removing the shock itself, use a really high quality Allen key. Make sure it has a decent fit within those shock bolts. And when you undo the Allen key, just take into account that your shock bolts might have quite a substantial amount of thread lock on them. So make sure the Allen key is located in there correctly, because if it's got a lot of thread lock, you have to overcome that force first. And if it's not in and it slips, you're gonna damage the head of the bolt. And that is not good, because it can be very difficult to remove these. Another thing to take into account, as I remove this rearward bolt here, the back end is gonna drop. And in this case, on the design of the bike, the rocker is gonna touch the frame. And I don't want that to damage it, which is why I removed the wheel. So I'm just gonna actually hold the back end of the bike so I can remove this without allowing it to drop. Now, as you see, I'm just gonna let this drop back against the tube with no damage and just rotate the shock down. Now, as with all shocks, they're gonna have different sort of setups, but this one is one with a bearing mount. So it's got these little plates over the bearings. Just make sure you take these off now and put them somewhere safe, because they're easy to drop off and lose. Now, because the back end of the shock has been released, just wanna hold the shock body itself whilst you free up the front one as well. Okay, now time to remove that bolt. This particular one has a captive nut on the other side, so you want to make sure that that doesn't drop out and go anywhere. And then just slide the bolt out and remove the shock from the bike. If you've not done this process on the bike and you want to actually undo the shock sleeve in a vise, just make sure that the bottom of the shock here is protected by soft jaws, or actually putting something in the vise, like some wood, something like that. You don't want to be clamping onto this and damaging it. Now, before I can actually remove this, what I wanted to show you is the end of the shock is a little bit different now. So you've got a bearing mount on here, and of course that's not going to enable me to slide this part of the shock up and over it. You actually have to remove this from the shock. On traditional setups, you have a bushing that runs through the end, and it will have some spaces. Normally, you can just remove those spaces and then you can slide it up. You don't normally need to remove the bushing. So like I said, I'm just going to remove this from the top here, which uses a 3mm Allen key. Now it's had those two 3mm bolts freed on the top, and that can just slide straight off the top of the shock there. And this would need some cleaning. Next up is to remove the O-ring here. This is the one that you use to set your sag. Put that in a safe place. If it's damaged, you can sort that out after. And if for some reason you don't like the red ones, now's a good opportunity to put black one on there. Now, when it comes to sliding the actual body off itself, you've got to bear in mind that if anything's sticking out, it could still damage the seal. So just be very careful as you do this. And sometimes you can expect a bit of friction just as you slide over the edge. But in this case, it slides off nicely. So I'm just gonna put that on my shop tail there. So next up in this case is just to slide off the countermeasure spring there. Slide that up and put that down on a base. And now it's time to give your shock body itself a nice bit of a clean and tidy. Now, just something to note as well, you can see here I've got some volume spacers inside here to increase how the shock ramps up at the end of travel. If you've not got any, now is the ideal time to fit some. And if you're just doing the job of fitting some volume spacers to your shock, it's also a good idea to do this process and give it a bit of a clean. So now it's time to just give it a good clean down, and then we're gonna inspect it to make sure everything is in good condition. The sealing on them generally is really, really good, but I can still let dirt and muck in, and that will actually wear stuff down bit by bit. This particular shock isn't that old, despite how dusty and grubby it looks on the outside, but you can never tell. It does depend on the conditions you're riding. Now, it's a good idea to know what sort of intervals you should be actually performing a shock service on your bike. And RockShox, for example, recommend that every 50 hours of riding that you replace the seals here. So it's a quad seal with bushes and the same on the actual sleeve. But think of this as a bit of an interim service. It's an inspection, it's a clean, and then you're just gonna be keeping on top of things. So I'm not replacing anything in this service, but I am just going to inspect it and make sure that everything looks like it's in good condition. If there are any obvious signs of wear, then obviously now is your chance to order those spare parts, or if you're unsure about changing them, take them to your local bike shop. But it's a fairly easy process, especially when you've gone this far. But I can see here by looking at this that the quad seal is actually in really good condition. There's no problem with that at all. And the bushes look pretty much like new actually. They're not bad at all. You also want to be inspecting the actual air shaft itself on the inside here. And the thing you're looking for is any scoring that you might get on that. Now, some bike designs can lead to the shock bending slightly in use. And if that's the case, then you can end up with scoring on the air shaft, which can create further damage down the line. Now, the same thing applies to the actual air sleeve itself. The damage and sort of wear and tear you're looking for are on the main wiper seal here and just on the inside. So give that a proper clean and have a look at that. And then also you want to check the threads are good. There's an O-ring there. Make sure that is in good condition. If for any reason it's sort of perished or deteriorated, get that replaced. It's just an O-ring. And make sure you run your finger around on the inside. Now you'll note there's a couple of indents on the inside there. That's basically for the air to swap between positive and negative chambers. But if there's anything else or any other sort of damage, you might need a new air sleeve. So just be quite vigilant, have a good look on the inside there, and just generally make sure it looks like it's in good condition. If there's anything you're unsure about, just be sure to ask your local bike shop or check on the RockShox, Fox or DVO websites, because they will have a frequently asked questions part on their maintenance section. Next up, you guessed it, is making sure that the bearings in this particular shock are clean and they rotate nice and smoothly. If there's any sort of notchiness to the bearings or they just feel like they're generally shot, you need to replace these. On this type of linkage bike, it's not that much of a problem, it just won't work that well. But on some bikes, for example, if you've got a clevis driving a shock directly and there isn't a linkage to support that, if you're adding friction on at this point or at the other end of the shock, you're putting strain on the actual shock itself and the shock can bend. And we have seen recently some pictures of shocks online that have actually snapped in the middle from this. So it is important just to keep on top of things. It doesn't involve having to do any crazy maintenance yourself, just common sense, just making sure that your bike is in good working order. Now at the top end of this particular air shock, it's got a conventional bush running through there. So it's also a good idea just to check that that does move and there's no sort of play within that. They're a fairly cheap part to replace, so I do recommend having a look at that. If there's any movement, get some ordered up and refit those. Okay, so now it's time to literally reverse the procedure and get everything back together again. Again, just taking care to make sure you put everything back on in the correct order. I'm using a bit of SRAM butter. It's their shock grease, basically it's designed for fork seals and that just to smear onto the actual seals themselves. It helps them glide a little bit easier on the inside and it does obviously form a slightly better seal. Now just delicately put some under the actual wiper seal there too. No need to go crazy because they do a pretty good job. And it's a case of sliding that air sleeve back on. Delicately push it over the end of the shock there. There we go. And sending it back home there. So it's just a case of putting the air sleeve back in place now. Now you can find that it's easier to do this when it's back on the bike. You can do this in a vice. There's a few different ways. What I like to do is actually do this here at this point. I'm just going to put a tiny bit more grease just on the threads there, just to make sure that they take in nicely. Now a case of sliding the sleeve back in place, you have to compress it at the same time and make sure the threads line up nice and smoothly, and then just tighten this up. Now, because my hands are actually quite greasy here and so is the body, I'm going to complete this when it's on the bike, just to get it in the right position. I'm just going to nip this up those. I actually can't tighten that anymore with my greasy hands. But now it's time to put the end back on the shock. Now, it's a good idea to put fresh thread lock onto the bolts because it is the sort of thing that can rattle loose in time. Always a good thing to do. And then just run this into the shock. Okay, so there we go, the shock is back in one piece. Don't forget, I just need to make sure that the sleeve is tightened sufficiently, but I'm gonna do that back on the bike because I've got my third hand, which of course are the main shock bolts. Just gonna give it a wipe over with some isopropyl alcohol because it's got a bit of grease from a glove, so now's the time to actually change your gloves and get rid of those. Then you want to make sure you reassemble it, put some thread lock on those shock bolts because they can rattle loose, especially if you like doing sort of bike park style riding with lots of vibration and stuff. And then it's time to reinflate the shock. So there we go, that is the basic air can service. It's something that I hope all of you guys are going to start doing at home. You can do it on any shock, Fox, Rock Shocks, etc. It's the same principle and it does keep it working nicely. As you can see, my shock looks really nice and clean. The best rest of the bike needs a bit more attention, actually, to be honest. For a couple more videos, click down here for a bike fit clinic. So that's everything you need to know about getting your bike fit, right? And click up here for a fork lower leg service if you fancy doing something a bit more in depth like this, but on your front forks. As always, click on the round globe to subscribe to GMBN Tech and go to our shop if you want to buy some of this cool stuff because it really helps us out here at the channel. And as always, if you like fixing your bike, give us a thumbs up.